Ooh, it's chilling in here. Oh no, an enemy! Pew pew! Pew pew! You guessed it. Today we are going to talk about the Cold War. I think it's pretty fair to say that geography and history are not my fields of expertise. And in fact, I have no idea what day is today, and I'm still not sure where Moldova is. What I'd like to talk about is science, biology, curious facts, and
death.
So prepare your gas masks and antidotes, because today we are going to talk about biological warfare. The Cold War, a period of geopolitical tension between two superpowers, the United States and the Soviet Union, ranging approximately from the end of World War II to the 90s. Today we associate this period to espionage and the development of nuclear arsenal, as well as the space race. But there is one topic that is at the intersection between my fields of interest and the Cold War, and that is biological warfare. And I know it sounds like the next Call of Duty, but it's not. So what is biological warfare? Well, in a nutshell, you take an organism or a microorganism, a bacterium, a fungus, a virus, or a toxin that is derived from an organism that is capable of harming humans, and use that with the intent of killing, harming, or causing diseases in other humans or animals or plants used by them as an act of war. It's essentially public health, but in reverse. Of course, the weaponization of biological system didn't start with the Cold War. The first biological weapon that was described in Western literature dates back to at least ancient Greece. Hercules dipped his arrows in serpent venom. The word poison itself was linked to the weapon. In fact, in ancient Greek, the word poison, toxikon, is derived from the word toxon, which means arrow. Poison does meaning for the arrow, something for the arrow. Humans have been using biological weapons of all sorts countless times, without knowing the true nature of the tool though. And it's only with the advent of the 20th century and the advancement in microbiology that biological warfare took a major leap forward. In particular, the end of World War II and the first years of the Cold War really marked a turning point for the American biological warfare, which, on orders from President Franklin Roosevelt, shifted from a crash program aimed at the development of a workable munition to a systematic effort to create the ideal biological weapon. And when you think about it, it makes so much sense to use biological agents in war. During all wars prior to World War II, way more men had been killed by diseases than by actual combat. Malaria, cholera, bubonic plague, you name it. So why not trying to control a natural and prefabricated agent of destruction and use it against your enemy? Well, because it was vile and inhuman, maybe? At least that's why the 1925 Geneva Convention prohibited the use of biological weapons. The use, not the possession or the development. Only the use. And the Cold War was a period of fear, secrecy, and speculation. Many countries, including the US, still developed and tested bioweapons just in case it was necessary for retaliation. And yeah, it's pretty obvious at this point that massive retaliation was a pretty common strategy during the Cold War. In the United States, the center of the biological weapons program was Camp Detrick in Maryland, later known as Fort Detrick. The program ran from 1943 to 1969, when it was discontinued during Nixon's administration. And then in 1972, the US signed the Biological and Toxic Weapons Convention, which prohibited not only the use, but also the research on bioweapons. So for the first half of the Cold War, the United States conducted research on around 30 biological agents, including these that you see on the screen right now. Among those, 6 were mass-produced and battle-ready: anthrax, tularemia, brucellosis, Q fever, VEE, and botulism. And among these, anthrax is probably the most famous. It has been often considered the perfect military pathogen, but in order to understand this, we need to define what makes a bioweapon a good bioweapon. This looked like a rabbit or something. The weaponization of biological agents is way more complicated than producing bullets, for example. You want your agent to be easy to produce, to store, to handle, and at the same time, you want it to remain potent during all these steps. You want your weapon to infect reliably in small doses, to be resistant to medical treatment, to be easy to disseminate and capable of surviving environmental stresses. And ideally, you also want your troops to be protected against the agent. Anthrax, the disease caused by Bacillus anthracis, is terrifying. The bacterium can get into your body through your skin, your lungs, or your gastrointestinal system. It causes blisters, body aches, fever, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, headache. Think of any physical discomfort, anthrax got you covered. If you get it through your skin and don't treat it, you have 20% chance of dying. If you breathe in anthrax, you just die. And let's say you're lucky and you have access to aggressive treatment, well, you're not super lucky because you still have 50% chance of dying. Anthrax is a spore-forming microbe, so when the environmental conditions are unfavorable, the bacterium curls itself up in a tiny and resistant ball. This way, it can survive for decades without loss of virulence. Anthrax is invisible, odorless, tasteless, infectious, and deadly. But if at first the focus was on finding the most lethal bioweapon, then the goal, especially in the 60s, shifted from lethality to incapacitation. Probably because it made more sense for bioweapons not to compete directly with the power of the atomic bomb, but instead to offer a diversified arsenal to the US Air Force. Brucella suis, which causes brucellosis, was a perfect candidate for that. It rarely killed people, but the victims still suffered fever, fatigue, muscle pain, headache, irritability, infection of bones and joints, and all of this for a period lasting sometimes a year or longer. And that's not it, because brucellosis is also known as undulant, how do you say this word? Undulant fever, because the symptoms came in waves, constantly appearing and disappearing. So Brucella suis slowly became the first standardized biological bomb, becoming the official American biological weapon. Of course, all of this required an immense amount of testing, and among all those tests, one in particular piqued my interest and curiosity. The Dagway Proving Center in Utah was a testing center for chemical and biological weapons. So in 1952, the Americans wanted to test the operational suitability of the M33 Brucella cluster bomb. 108 Brucella-filled bomblets bound together in a cluster adapter for a total of around 225 kilograms, which is around 500 pounds. The bomb was dropped on the Dagwe bombing zone, where an artificial village was built on purpose for the test. A big square of around 2 kilometers per side, around 6,000 feet, and in this square, 49 identical houses with one door and windows that were closed. And inside each one of these houses were 10 guinea pigs in cages. Add to that the outdoor population for a total of 3,230 guinea pigs in one testing session, one among many others. And now I cannot stop picturing the contrast between this highly sophisticated technology to bomb cities with clouds of pathogens and a cute family of guinea pigs having a barbecue outdoor in their nice guinea pig town. It is so dramatic, and at the same time, it's somehow comedic. And I joke about this, but it was actually terrible. Thousands and thousands of animals of all sorts, including humans, were used in order to test the efficiency and the effects of bioagents. So this was used as an example of how far behind the development and the efficiency of bioweapons were at the time. People started realizing that bioweapons were the atomic bombs of the poor man. And indeed, if you had to compare the advancement of those two technologies in that period, the 50s, for example, on one side, the US already used the atomic bomb twice on civilians. And on the other, well, their biggest achievement was spraying aerosols on a village of guinea pigs. Add to that the growth in opposition to the Vietnam War, the public awareness of the development of bioweapons, the discovery of human testing, and also the discovery of open air experiments in cities, in American cities, like in the Bay Area or the New York subway. So Nixon's decision to terminate the bioweapon program was was deeply linked to the growing negative perception of biological weapons. I started studying the subject a few weeks ago, and there is so much to talk about, so many stories to tell, and I've been focusing mainly on some aspects of the bioweapons in the United States during the Cold War, but you know, the Soviet Union also had its crazy development programs, and I found the science behind all of that super fascinating, and it also shows some, well, questionable nuances of our own humanity, not thousands of years ago, just a little bit more than 50 years ago. I'm also super fascinated by those different conventions I talked to you about. I think it's pretty ironic that we have rules for how to make war. Yeah, and I hope I get to tell you more about the stuff I discovered in the future. And if you want to learn more about the Cold War, I invite you to go check out the rest of this beautiful playlist, the Project MAD, the Project MAD playlist. So that's it for me today. I hope you enjoyed the video, and I'll see you very soon. Bye. Oh, this is comfy. I'm gonna sleep here tonight.